Thousands of witches were burned alive at the stake.
Today, there is still persecution.
A werewolf is evil incarnate.
There is a vampire in all of us. I'm fascinated by the sight of blood.
In the terrifying world of monsters, all roads lead to the graveyard. For it is here that the werewolves prowl, the witches cast their evil spells, and the vampires rise from the dead. Or at least so they tell us. But where exactly do the legends end and the facts begin? I mean, are these simply wild tales from a fevered mind? Or do they have a basis in some horrible truth? Tonight, we'll search for the answers. Is a haunting sound that can fill your imagination with fear. And it is fear of that wild animal that has sparked so many legends, one of which is the werewolf. In folklore, the werewolf is a person who literally has been transformed into a wolf, a real wolf. But when Hollywood got its hands on the legend, reality left the picture. What we got instead was a distraught actor having a bad hair day. And we learned that anyone, even an upstanding family man, could go to the wolves.
Duncan, darling, this is Helen. These men have promised not to harm you. Miss Craig!
Now, if that wasn't scary enough, everyone in town would chase the poor creature into a murky swamp and then act surprised when they got attacked.
His throat.
And of course, everyone had their own theories about what was happening.
Whoever is bitten by a werewolf and lives becomes a werewolf himself.
Oh, don't hand me that. You're just wasting your time.
The wolf bit you, didn't he?
Yeah. Yeah, he did.
It was enough to make a good legend roll over and play dead. But the true legend of the man-eating, grave-robbing werewolf lives on. It's actually based on the behavior of real wolves. These animals are natural scavengers, and centuries ago, they often prowled cemeteries to feed on the bodies buried there. Remember, this was long before the dead were buried inside coffins 6 feet under. Of course, anyone seeing these animals in the light of the moon might easily have mistaken them for a monster. And the tales of what they saw grew into the myth of the werewolf.
In mythology and legend, the werewolf is associated with the nighttime, with savage behavior, with antisocial behavior. The werewolf is often thought to be a demon or to be a person who has become the puppet of demons.
Another common theory was that the devil might possess a real wolf and cause the wolf to wreak havoc.
In addition, there is ample evidence that from time immemorial, people have believed that they could transform themselves into wolves.
If you look at the folklore, there is nothing there about half-man, half-wolf creatures. Werewolves simply look like other wolves. They are not different. The only difference is that they are animated by the spirit of a witch or sorcerer of some kind.
Sometimes our worst fears can become another person's reality. Although it's unlikely that anyone can be physically transformed into a wolf, There have been cases of people who have mentally transformed themselves into wild animals. The term used to describe this rare psychiatric condition is lycanthropy.
Now, the word lycanthropy actually is related to Greek mythology. Zeus became enraged at the king of Lycan, and he transformed him into a raging wolf. And so we get from lycanthropy. The whole idea of lycanthropy is someone appearing or thinking of themselves as a wolf. Approximately 20 years ago, while I was working on an inpatient psychiatric service, I discovered a case of schizophrenia, which in fact turned out to be a case of lycanthropy.
Hello, sorry I'm late. I am Dr. Rosenstein.
The first time I saw this particular individual, she appeared frightened, out of control. She was sitting in a chair, holding on to various pieces of furniture, trying to explain something that she just couldn't explain.
I have no fear.
My first impression was that we had a terribly psychotic woman. But what was most unusual was that this lady was having a very peculiar delusion, namely envisioning herself in the form of a wolf.
According to Dr. Rosenstock, the woman was too confused to describe her own behavior.
Don't!
But members of her family explained to him what had taken place at a recent family gathering.
Oh, look at that. Oh, that looked good. You know,
she completely became overwhelmed by impulses that directed her to behave in a wolf-like fashion.
And that we're here as a family to share it.
She began to make noises, gnawing sounds, and snarling sounds, and growling sounds. She was being directed by forces completely out of her control. And this resulted in tremendous alarm among the family members. She was taken home and seemed to calm down for a while. It was later that she began to take on persistent animal-like qualities. She had terrible urges and terrible obsessions. When she would look into the mirror, instead of seeing her face, would see the face of a wolf.
The doctor met with his patient for psychiatric sessions every day during her stay in the hospital.
You've been taking your pills.
She would describe that she is starting to regress back into a wolf-like form, or that she would be engaged by a wolf-like delusion.
I'm afraid to look in the mirror.
What do you see when you look in the mirror?
It's not the wolf, it's just the eyes. The eyes are different.
She saw two eyes. One was different from the other. One was a very normal eye, and one was a very evil eye.
Dr. Rosenstock placed his patient in a secure therapeutic environment and prescribed antipsychotic medication for her.
At some point, when she was doing very much better, there were conversations about the wolf.
Fangs and everything was horrible.
I think the wolf represented for her evil incarnate, and she could see herself as a sinner. It's a very ironic issue. In reality, we shouldn't be that afraid of wolves, unless they're starving or unless they're injured. They usually don't attack human beings. In fact, if they have an aberrant member of that community who might be threatening and break the rules of the pack, they actually destroy that particular member. People have a built-in fear of the wolf. We probably don't realize how we inculcate within our children the fear
of a wolf.
And then three pigs, who's afraid of the big bad wolf? All of a sudden, we're saying to our children, there's something very evil, something that can be life-threatening. We always say to a child, don't cry wolf, because one day you will and you won't be saved. We even use the expression, don't wolf down your food. And we're communicating, be careful lest you take on some type of animalistic quality.
And so we grow up fearing the wolf, hearing stories of grandmothers being eaten alive and crafty wolves disguised in sheep's clothing. And out of these tales comes the greatest fear of all, that we ourselves might actually turn into a wolf. But the legend of the werewolf remains just that, a legend, a figure of folklore, a real wolf animated by the spirit of a sorcerer or a witch. Still to come, witches. Are they wicked or just misunderstood?
We're not green. Most of us do not cackle. So therefore, we're difficult to recognize.
Also, the real Dracula. He may be more frightening than you've ever imagined. Beware of witches, or so we're told. They're wicked. They're treacherous. They're deceitful. And they're also great fun. What would Halloween be without a witch? Or can you imagine Hansel and Gretel without one? All you'd have left is two kids and some breadcrumbs. And yet, the witch has been a source of ridicule for centuries. Folklore and legend have saddled her with very dark and sinister attributes. She's usually depicted as an ugly old hag with a wart on her nose. No wonder she stayed home until after dark. She'd emerge at midnight, the witching hour, riding her broomstick across the sky. Now, it may be difficult to imagine, but this had to be even more uncomfortable than flying coach. But there was a purpose to her discomfort. She could use the broom to sweep her tracks from the sky. Her fashion sense, however, was not as discreet. She took to wearing large pointed hats, a dead giveaway that she was evil. You see, in earlier times, this style of hat was frowned on by the church, which equated the point with the horn of a devil. So anyone wearing such a hat would, of course, be in league with the devil. In spite of all the negative stereotypes that folklore has heaped on the witch, there is a large and growing number of people today who are proud to call themselves witches. They practice a pagan religion called Wicca, from the old English word for wise. Wiccan priestess Selena Fox explains.
Witchcraft is not only alive and well in the United States, but it is around the world. And by witchcraft, I mean the ancient nature religion. The word witch has a lot of baggage. One of the things that people think about when they hear the word witch is evil of some sort. We do not worship Satan. We don't believe in Satan. The idea of witchcraft and Satanism becoming synonymous is a result of the negative PR campaign that was done during the Middle Ages.
For several hundred years, a witch hysteria swept throughout Europe that cost thousands of innocent people their lives. It was a period in history the witches call the burning times.
It was the time where reason was thrown out the window. If someone happened to not be popular in a community, or if someone wanted their land, all one had to do was make an accusation that the person was a witch, and the trouble would begin for that person.
Once someone was accused, they went through a series of intense interrogations.
Woman, stand up.
Now tell me, Agnes, Do you know John Bell?
Torture was commonly used during these interrogations. People were tortured until they either gave up or died.
You spin well. So, we must find the mark. We must find the mark.
And when they gave up, they were forced to sign confessions that they had participated in black witchcraft and devil worship.
Woman!
I said, did you?
People lost their lands. People would rot in prisons for years, were hung or stoned to death. People were burned alive at the stake.
Some claim the men and women burning the witches were actually saving the souls of the convicted sinners.
People that called themselves Christian did some very unchristian-like things. Instead of loving their neighbor as themselves, they exterminated their neighbors, all in the name of eradicating evil. Hundreds of thousands, and some say even millions of people died during this rampage.
All from the fear of witchcraft. But the hysteria wasn't confined to Europe alone. In 1692, it found its way across the Atlantic to the small settlement of Salem, Massachusetts. It began in a kitchen where some young girls and a cook were playing with magic.
What do you see?
What happened next is a mystery that ended in tragedy.
In January of 1692, a little girl named Betty Paris became ill. She was the daughter of the minister of Salem Village. Before long, her cousin, Abigail Williams, who lived in the house with her, became ill as well.
Doctor, what ails them?
Reverend Paris called in a doctor. The doctor examined the young girls and, having no medical explanation for their illness, declared that they had been bewitched.
The thing to do then was to find out who was doing the bewitching, punish those people, and all would be well.
At first, the girls refused to name the people who were supposedly bewitching them. But eventually, and most likely out of fear that their own experiments with magic would be discovered, the frightened youngsters began to name names.
Having committed sundry acts of witchcraft and sorcery.
And the Salem witch trials were off and running.
It was a time of terrible fear, because it was likely that if you defended somebody or spoke for somebody who was accused, you would be accused yourself. It was a time of great courage as well, because many of the people that were accused refused to confess to something that they hadn't done and went to their deaths with enormous dignity.
Confess now to God Almighty of your sins. You are a witch.
You are a liar. I'm no more a witch than you are a wizard.
Before it was over, 141 people would be arrested, and 20 would be put to death on what is now called Gallows Hill. Whether or not the people who died on Gallows Hill were actually witches will never be known. In fact, it's very possible there were no witches in Salem at all at that time. But the same can't be said about today, for Salem has become a mecca for witches, and one of the most visible is Laurie Cabot.
There are 4,000 witches in Salem today, and we do rituals on Gallows Hill. If someone stumbled upon our ritual in the forest, they might be frightened because not many people have seen a witch's ritual or understand that it's a nature religion.
A very important part of most witchcraft rituals is the creation of sacred space. This typically takes the form of casting a circle.
And we bless Mother Earth.
The witch's pointed hat represents the sacred circle in which rituals are done. There are certain basic tools that witches use. The pentacle, incense, often in a cauldron. The cauldron for witches throughout Europe during the Middle Ages and before was used as part of folk healing. The old wise women who did the healing for their villages also had brooms, and some say that during the burning times, that the broom was a way of concealing the witch's staff that was used in the casting of magic circles.
I've cast spells just like other people pray.
And we raise the cone of power.
To heal someone, to have someone have a prosperous life, for happiness.
And we bless.
I think many religions use their prayers and their magic to manipulate the world and people around them. That is harmful magic.
We ask for clean air, clean water.
Witches do not cast evil spells. Witches do not try to control other people. Unfortunately, some people hear the word witch and immediately think the worst.
For many years, the image that came to mind was that they flew on brooms and they were frightening. But what we're trying to do is help people to understand us so they don't need to fear us ever again. The future of witchcraft is as strong and as endless as our ancient history. Witches will never disappear from the earth.
And the world is a far more interesting place with them in it. Now, vampires, on the other hand, might not be as sorely missed, especially if they're real. Find out right after this.
Next, one man's incredible search for the real Dracula, plus modern-day vampires, murderers who have killed for blood. Image of the classic vampire has been greatly influenced by Bram Stoker's Dracula. A black-caped count from Transylvania. A creature with fangs and a taste for blood. A monster that shuns the cross in the light of day. Diabolical fiend who can only be destroyed by a stake through the heart.
Fortunately for us, Count Dracula is only a fictional character. Or is he? Could this symbol of the living dead, a man who sleeps in his coffin by day and searches for blood by night, could this vampire have actually existed? It's a question that captured the imagination of one man, Dr. Raymond McNally, an historian who re-examined Stoker's novel with a detective's eye.
I noticed that the places were real. Transylvania is real. It's part of Romania. Many people still think Transylvania is made up somehow. It's not made up, it's real. And I had this intuition that if the author went to such pains to be correct, impeccably so, about those places, I bet he based that figure that he has in that novel upon somebody who existed. So I started asking Hungarian scholars, was there anybody like Dracula? Does the name mean anything to you? Could there have been such a person? And I'd reached a complete dead end. I was told, you're a fool, you won't find out anything. This is all folklore, it's a vampire story made up by the wild imagination of this author, Bram Stoker. Forget about it.
But Dr. McNally couldn't forget about it. The prospect of discovering the real Dracula was too intriguing. And so, he learned Romanian, and in 1972, he received a Fulbright Fellowship. Dr. McNally was finally on his way to Transylvania to hunt for a vampire.
I went in search of the real Dracula, and he turned out to be an extremely interesting, very sadistic kind of person.
McNally discovered his first clue at a 15th century home in the ancient Romanian city of Sighișoara.
There's a plaque at the house that says that Vlad Dracul lived here from 1431 to 1436. The father's name was Vlad Dracul, from the Order of the Dragon. The son is Vlad Dracula. The A in Romanian is like son of Dracul. So the connection with the Dracula that we know through the literature was clearly there. In the 15th century, this Dracula was a very well-known character. He was a horror figure already.
Armed with only a Super 8 movie camera, McNally followed the trail of Vlad Dracula through ransacked villages and desecrated monasteries. It was a bloody trail that eventually led him to the ruins of a medieval tower.
Cândia Tower is a tower at Târgoviște, which is the old capital of Romania in medieval times. Now, it is from that tower Dracula constructed a field called the Forest of the Impaled. Some 30,000 victims up on stakes and poles. Some of those victims had been up there for weeks. It's not a quick death. It's a terrible way to die. What is the purpose? That purpose is to show a lesson, a very powerful lesson.
Dr. McNally believes it was a graphic warning for the Turkish general Mohammed II, who was intent on destroying Dracula.
So the great conqueror, Muhammad II, when he came with his forces, outnumbering Dracula 3-1, but when he came to that field, the Forest of the Impaled, he said, "What can you do against a man who does such terrible things?" And he took his forces, and he went home.
Dr. McNally had indeed discovered a monster, a titled aristocrat and military leader named Dracula. But was this Dracula merely a ruthless killer? Or was he actually a vampire, someone who drank blood?
One of the new discoveries show that Dracula liked to dine amid his impaled victims. Can you believe that? The stench must have been excruciating. And we have woodcuts, contemporary woodcuts, showing that. Anyway, he gathered the blood from his victims in bowls, and then he took bread and he dipped it in the blood and slurped it down. So he was, by anybody's definition, a living vampire.
When we return, a psychological condition that might actually turn people into vampires. And an interview with a woman who claims to be one. Witches, werewolves, and vampires will return in a moment.
Dr. McNally is convinced that he finally solved the mystery he'd read between the lines of Bram Stoker's novel, that the character of Dracula was based on a real person. But even if that's true, it isn't Vlad Dracula who springs to mind when you mention the word vampire. It's the character in books and movies that strikes terror in our hearts.
I believe that Dracula achieved his true immortality through the movies. And it's Nosferatu, that classic German movie. That's the best Dracula movie ever made, in my opinion, that launched the career of Dracula and made him immortal. Actually, the character in there looks like a vampire should look. It looks like the vampire of folklore, emaciated, ugly, disgusting in the extreme, and very, very scary. After all, it's a corpse. It's a walking corpse. It's been in the grave for a while. And that's the way it is in the folklore.
To understand the significance of this folklore, it's necessary to examine the attitude the medieval world held regarding death.
In The assumption was that death came from the dead. In other words, if one person died and then a whole bunch of other people died, people assumed that the first person had brought death to the others. And typically what they did was dig up the corpse of the first person and inspect it for evidence that it was a vampire. For example, they would discover that the corpse would often have blood at its lips. The conclusion that they drew was that the reason why the corpse had blood at its lips and was larger than it had been was that it had been drinking the blood of the living.
Modern forensic science has provided a more rational explanation for this phenomenon. As a dead body decomposes, it creates gases which build up pressure in the lungs, forcing blood up through the mouth and onto the lips of the corpse. But without this medical knowledge, it's easy to understand how this natural process could be misinterpreted. And according to Dr. McNally, these superstitions and legends of the living dead survive in parts of Eastern Europe even today.
People in Transylvania still believe passionately in vampires, even though most of them have never seen a Dracula movie and they've never read the novel. I'll give you one example. When I was traveling, I met a girl whose father was a vampire. Yes, Tinka, her name. I said, "What do you mean your father was a vampire?" She said, "When he died, he was laid out to rest. And after 3 days, they noticed rigor mortis had not set in. The skin was still pliable. Cheeks bore a ruddy complexion. These are the signs of the vampire in that part of the world, the undead." So she told me she couldn't do what had to be done because it was the body of her own father. But the villagers did. And they did what is done in the horror movies. They took a wooden stake and they plunged it through the heart of the corpse, keep it from walking. Got to drive it through the body and into the ground underneath the corpse. That's what pins it to the earth.
Legends surrounding the vampire have provided terrified villagers with additional methods to protect themselves against the myth of the living dead. One of their folk remedies came from the notion that anything already dead and buried probably wouldn't have an especially pleasant odor when it came back to life.
Vampires were known to have themselves a very strong smell. And there's an old expression in Latin, similia similiis curantur. Similar things are cured by similar things. This belief caused people to feel that if the vampire has a strong smell, then what you should do to ward the vampire off is to put things that have strong smells around you. Garlic would typically be hung up in areas where vampires could enter. For example, you might hang garlic around the windows. Other things that ward off vampires are anything that's sharp. So people would put knives under their pillows or to embroider roses around any opening in the clothing. And the assumption there is that roses have thorns, vampires don't like things that are sharp, and therefore these things will keep away the vampires.
While men like Dr. McNally and Paul Barber explored the myth in the vampire fiction and folklore and history, other experts turned their attention to the psychological and criminal side of vampirism. What they discovered, if true, is both fascinating and terrifying.
Researchers nowadays believe that in addition to the vampire as a figure of myth and legend, there are certain conditions that actually lead to people developing the craving to drink human blood. Now, when I'm talking about vampires in the modern context, obviously I'm not talking about people who are transforming themselves into bats. At least I've never seen it. What I'm talking about are people who develop the compulsion to drink human blood. There's a typical pattern in the evolution of this condition that's been dubbed Renfield syndrome, named after the blood-drinking psychotic character in Bram Stoker's Dracula. The first stage generally begins in childhood. Some kind of critical incident occurs where the young person, boy or girl, but usually a boy, discovers that drinking blood can be exciting. This can lead to a second stage of what is known as auto-vampirism, or the lust for one's own blood. That then can evolve to a third stage known as zoophagia. This involves the consumption of non-human animals in order to drink their blood. So watch out for your dogs and cats in the neighborhood. Vampires at this stage might grab pets. The most advanced stage of Renfield's syndrome is true vampirism, which involves the drinking of the blood of other human beings. Some people who have reached this stage sneak into hospitals and blood banks and try and steal blood from the storage there. This stage of Renfield's syndrome can develop into serial murder. These people actually take blood involuntarily from other human beings. I think the most notorious case in modern times of a serial murderer who apparently had Renfield syndrome, clinical vampirism, was the Hague case.
During the late 1940s, English newspapers recounted the bizarre tale of John George Hague,
and you'll understand,
a dapper gentleman who became known as the London Vampire. Hague's victims were his friends, people who trusted him.
Don't go far.
He would lure them to an abandoned warehouse on the edge of town.
John?
They thought they were going to visit his place of business.
I can't see anything.
They didn't know they were going to their debts.
I'm getting the light.
Oh, John, do hurry. I really can't see.
Hague killed his victims quickly, usually with a gunshot to the back of the head. Reports suggest that Hague's obsession with blood began as a child. His parents frequently beat him, and one day, while being struck with a hairbrush, the bristles drew blood. He sucked the wound and enjoyed the taste. Like a classic case of Renfield syndrome, eventually, his own blood couldn't satisfy him, and Hague began killing for a fresh supply. In addition to their blood, he also robbed his victims of their personal possessions, even going so far as to forge their names to gain access to their property. Hague confessed to killing 9 people over a period of several years before he was finally captured and convicted. John George Hague was executed for murder in 1949. Coming up, she sleeps in a coffin and drinks blood, but is she a vampire? The strange case of the London Vampire sent shockwaves around the world nearly half a century ago.
John George Hague is not the only person considered to be a modern-day clinical vampire. Unfortunately, during the last 20 years, there have been numerous reports of other people who were so psychologically damaged, so criminally insane, that they actually acted upon the impulse to commit murder for blood.
New York, 1975. A woman is arrested for a grisly homicide that involved the siphoning of the victim's blood. California, 1978. Richard Trenton Chase is convicted of multiple murder, including at least one count of vampirism. His crimes earn him the nickname the Vampire Killer. Massachusetts, 1980. A young man with a history of mental illness hears a voice that tells him to use bullets painted gold to kill for blood. Only then will he be able to become a vampire.
Florida,
Florida, 1985, a 19-year-old woman accepts a ride from a man named John Brennan Crutchley, a successful high-tech engineer, who, after his capture, is dubbed the vampire rapist. Minnesota, 1988. After watching a modern vampire film, three teenagers decide to act out a similar scenario. They confront a 30-year-old vagrant who is unable to defend himself from their attack.
Fascination with blood and even with drinking blood is not restricted to serious psychiatric cases. My sense is that there probably have always been people involved in this. And the reason is that the sight of blood is, I believe, naturally exciting. Why is it that traffic slows almost to a stop whenever there's an accident? Because people slow down and they're looking for the red stuff. That orientation toward blood may well be programmed in the human being, because in the settings within which our species evolved, the sight of spilled blood indicates danger, indicates the presence of threat. Now, one of the properties of our species is that we can convert one type of physiological arousal, one type of being excited and turned on, into another type. For example, when we watch a horror movie, what is going on is that we're deliberately putting ourselves into a situation when we see monsters and often a lot of blood. We are being aroused by the fear stimuli, pressing those natural buttons inside ourselves. Another part of our mind, of course, knows that we're in a theater and we're safe. So we can convert the arousal of fear into the arousal of having a good time in a movie theater. So I think it's important, even though it may be kind of comforting, to distance ourselves from vampirism. I think perhaps it's not fully honest. I think that potentially there may be a vampire in all of us.
If not in all of us, there is a potential vampire in at least a small subculture of our society. People who believe, or say they believe, that they are vampires. I want you to meet Katrina Coffin.
I believe I'm a vampire because I do like the taste of blood, and I am nocturnal. I have a casket in my living room, and I do sleep in that. So if I've been up all night and the sun is coming up, I do not like the sun, and I can get into my casket, close the lid, and that way I don't have to deal with the sun or noise, and it's very comfortable and it's easy to sleep in. I drive a 1968 Cadillac hearse. I have a coffin in the back of my car for decoration. I'm very into the macabre. I have a lot of horror memorabilia around my house, and bats and rats and skulls and such. I have quite a few exotic animals. I like snakes, and I have a couple of tarantulas and a scorpion. I love the theatrics of vampirism. I like wearing the dark makeup. I like long fingernails. These are my real nails, and I've always been this way. When I was a child, if a friend of mine would fall and cut themselves, I would take the blood from the wound, and kids were kind of fascinated by it. They thought it was interesting. I don't bite people in the neck. Biting just leaves bruises. It doesn't draw blood. I don't need blood to survive, whereas someone like Dracula would have to have blood. I don't like the sun, but I won't disintegrate if I go out in it. I think there could be somewhere vampires that really are immortal, that live forever, need blood to survive. It's possible. There are ghosts and all types of other things, so anything is possible.
In every major city, I suspect that you could find interest in drinking blood, and I wouldn't necessarily want to say that that's the same thing as a psychiatric disorder. Having said that, however, a word of advice, drinking blood from your partner is not a safe sex practice. So I think a health advisory, don't bite your friends. You could acquire dangerous diseases.
Witches, werewolves, and vampires, are they real?
Well, as we've discovered tonight, that's a question that has no easy answer.
The myths and legends of these creatures have been handed down through time. They were created by people who needed to put a face on their fears, to find answers to mysteries that have no explanation, and to evaluate the good in their lives against a specter of evil. Today, we no longer need these mythological monsters to explain the evil in our world. But the fascination with them lives on. People of all ages continue to thrill to a good horror story. As long as the sun sets, the moon rises, and night turns the sky to black, witches will fly on their broomsticks, werewolves will howl at the moon, and vampires will rise from their graves.
And we will be there enjoying every moment of danger and suspense. Thank you for joining me tonight on our search for the unexplained. I'm Peter Graves. Good night.